And
Everyone's on cue. Good morning, everyone. I'm Richard Kravitz, UCCS Director. It's good to see all of you again. Welcome to the UCCS Undergraduate Student Showcase. This is a real highlight of every term. And I just wanted to say a couple things. First, how proud we are of all the students for getting your projects together and doing such amazing work, which we look forward very much to hearing about. And also, of course, to the internship hosts, many of you who have been with us quarter after quarter, supporting our programs in experiential learning. And we just want to let you know just how essential you are and how much we appreciate what you do for our students, for the University of California, and ultimately for the people of the state of California. So with that, I think we have lots to get done today. So let's move right along.
All right, fantastic. So the format for today's undergraduate research showcase is that each student will present. After the student presents, we will take one question from their internship host site. If there is not a question from the internship host site, then we turn it over to the academic team to ask the question. And so our first student is Kelly Xiao Lo, whose home campus is UC Davis. And this term she interned with the Office of Sacramento City Mayor Daryl Steinberg's office. Kelly?
Hi. So today I will be talking about racial disparity and how that correlates with recidivism rates. So racial disparity and recidivism rates is one of the most prevalent issues in the United States criminal justice system, where California leads as the second highest in recidivism and incarceration. So my hypothesis would be that Black and Latino people impacted by racial discrimination and unequal enforcement laws before reform causes higher recidivism rate. And my research method is to compare national and state data for prisoner recidivism rates of white and Black and Latino people of color. And furthermore, I will also measure recidivism rates of groups of offenders released over a span of 5 to 10 years before and after policy implementations. One of my findings is that among Black and Latino people, 30.1% had an arrest for a new crime within 6 months of release, for white people, only 25.6% had an arrest for a new crime within 6 months of release. And you can see that for figure one. And in conclusion, Black and Latino people have a higher recidivism rate than white people and are 17.4% average percentage points more likely to get rearrested. And as you can see in figure three, the share of Black and Latino offenders rearrested for a felony offense decreased from 56% to 53% in the 4 years after AB 109. Furthermore, recidivism rates also dropped from 30% to 22% during the implementation of Prop 47 in 2014. So in conclusion, Black and Latino prison populations did decline since realignment and dropped drastically in 2014 due to Prop 47. Some policy suggestions would be more focus on rehabilitation rather than retribution, more employment programs and eligibility for government aid after release, and remove cash bail since people of color are often below poverty line and cannot afford. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Kelly. And so a question from her internship host site. If you have a question, just go ahead and raise your hand. I'll call on you and unmute you. However, you will need to go ahead and unmute on your end too. All right, great. Julia Burrows.
Hi, Cindy, and hi, Kelly. This is Julia Burrows. I'm the Senior Policy Advisor in Mayor Steinberg's office. And Kelly did an amazing job this year working with Naila Popardin, who is launching an Environmental Justice Collaborative Governance Committee. So Kelly is one of the founders. She will always be one of the founders of our Environmental Justice Committee. And my question for you, Kelly, is that after you've analyzed these recidivism rates, do you think that efforts through environmental justice and those root causes for why people are incarcerated in the first place and return to prison, do you think there's a way through the environmental justice movement that we can reduce recidivism rates?
Thank you, Julia. Definitely. Having more housing and more and more clean air, clean water, so that people would not have to seek out the resources that are supposed to be provided for them elsewhere. More specifically, through if it's harder to obtain, such as fresh fruit, organic resources for their family, they would not have to seek out criminal options, more likely. And I feel like environmental justice plays like a really big role in criminality as well, reduction in criminal activity and such. So that would be a really good policy implementation as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. Congratulations on your good work.
All right. Thank you, Julia, for the question. And thank you, Kelly, for your presentation today. And so our next student is Lucas Liu, whose home campus is UC Davis. And he has interned this term with the Office of Sacramento City Council member Rick Jennings' office. Lucas?
Hello, everyone. My name is Lucas Liu. More than 90% of California's brief and healthy levels of one or more air pollutants. In 2010, California created the Clean Vehicle Rebates Program to provide rebates for Californians who buy clean passenger vehicles. I hypothesize that more rebate approvals will decrease transportation emissions. I expect there's an inverse relationship between the pollutants and rebates. This research is a comparative study of five different counties from 2010 to 2020. My independent variable is the number of rebates approved for each county for 100,000 persons. My dependent variables are four specific pollutants: ozone, carbon monoxide, nitrogen oxide, and PM2.5. Looking at figure 1, 2, and 3, all of them have inverse relationships. Except figure 4, ozone level have no relationships in most counties, probably due to external sources such as power plants, industrial boilers and refineries, and chemical plants. The Clean Vehicle Rebate Program should expand because the data demonstrate the percentage of people applying for rebates is relatively low. The state should evaluate the program on how to encourage more people to apply for the rebates to reach the statewide goal of reductions at least 40% below the 1990 levels of emission by 2030. Thank you.
All right, great. Thank you, Lucas. And so if there is a question from, all right, so we've got a question from Harry Atkins. Oh, there we go.
Hey everybody, this is Henry Atkinson from Councilmember Rick Jennings' office. Lucas was an outstanding intern in our office. The question that I have, Lucas, is on figures all four figures now that I think about it. It will say changes in the whatever level from 2010 to 2020. Then when I look at the actual chart itself, it's difficult to really figure out where time is, and I'm not really seeing it. And the reason I bring this up is since it's including the year 2020, and I imagine that emission levels are probably going to be different in 2020, and whatever trends that were going on from 2010 to 2019 would probably be different and upended in that year. Is that reflected at all in these charts, or is it sort of intentionally left off?
Oh, thank you, Henry. That's a great question. So each data point represents a year. So it's included 2020, the year of 2020 and 2019, like including the before the COVID-19 and after the COVID-19. So each data represents a year. So yeah, I hope that answers your question. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Henry, for the question and for hosting Lucas this term. And thank you, Lucas, for your presentation. So our next student is James Fenlon, and his home campus is UC Riverside. And this term he interned with the Sacramento Metropolitan Chamber of Commerce. James?
Hello, I'm James, and today I'll be covering unions, right to work laws, and wages. So wages have been largely unable to keep up with rising costs of living. And factors like union rates and right to work laws are key aspects of the wage discussion. While unions serve as a means to represent worker interests through organization, right to work laws allow workers to be in a union job without being in a union. The question ends up being, what is the effect of union rates and right to work laws on wages, and do such effects keep pace with cost of living? I hypothesize that states with high union rates will have higher wages than states with low rates and right to work laws. For my research, I studied comparable states such as California, Texas, New York, and Florida, which have similar population sizes and densities. I primarily used Bureau of Labor Statistics data from 2018 to keep consistency, and I measured average wage in dollars per hour and union rate as a percentage of workforce. For my findings, I was, as outlined in figure two, states with high union rates saw higher average wages, and states with right to work laws had lower union rates and lower average wages. When looking at livable wages, states with high union rates had larger, healthier gaps between average wage and livable wage compared to low union rate right to work states. The ultimate takeaway from this research seems to be that right to work laws and low union rates negatively impact hourly wages. Potential policy suggestions would be to eliminate right to work laws as well as expand union protections in order to increase union rates as well as increase average hourly wages. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, James. And so if there is a question from his internship host site, just go ahead and raise your hand and I'll go ahead and unmute you. Great, Jasmine. Hello.
Thank you, Cindy, and thanks, James, for that great presentation. Just one question for you. Did you see any impacts to that data that you had found as it ties to your hypothesis? In the past year or so from the ongoing pandemic, we've seen a lot of local ordinances as it relates to right to work and right to recall and things like that. Did you see any impacts in your research for that?
For this particular set of data, I used 2018 to stay consistent. But as for like lately, I know union rates have slightly gone up in California, and I believe in other states as well. Of course, they're nowhere near where they were in the 90s. But I know if you were in a union, you were less likely to get laid off because you have more protections. And then people who weren't in a union definitely were more likely to lose their jobs. And as for wages, I think pay cuts were happening across the board. So I think that's the effect that the pandemic had on union jobs as well as a lot of employment.
Great. Thank you, Jasmine, for the question. And thank you, James, for the presentation today. And Jasmine, thank you for hosting also James at the SAC Metro Chamber of Commerce. So our next student is Armando Lupion from his home campus is UC Merced. And he also interned with the Sacramento Metropolitan Chamber of Commerce this term.
Hello, and thank you. So my research topic is on Not All Wounds Are Visible, the impact of poverty levels and the shortages of mental health professionals on teen suicides in California counties. And in 2019, the United Health Foundation released a report that identified that California was one of seven states with significant increases in teen suicide rates, with an overall increase of 34% from 2016 to 2019, as displayed in figure one. Which led me to my question, if poverty and shortages of mental health professionals led to increases in teen suicide rates. I hypothesized that counties with the highest child poverty rates and the lowest rates of mental health professionals are more likely to experience higher rates of teen suicides. To test my hypotheses, a large-end study was conducted using data collected from 41 counties from 2016 to 2019 on populations under 18 living in poverty, teen suicides ages 10 to 19, and the number of mental health professionals per county. Ultimately, I found that counties that with higher child poverty rates are more likely to experience higher rates of teen suicides as displayed in figure two. Additionally, I also found that counties that have lower rates of mental health professionals per county are likely to experience higher rates of teen suicides as displayed in figure three. And based on these findings, it is essential for counties that have higher child poverty rates to promote access to mental health services in impoverished areas that may otherwise not have or be aware of such resources. And furthermore, there needs to be more advocacy in counties that have higher rates of teen suicides to attract and attain more mental health professionals in places that need it the most. Thank you.
All right, great. Thank you so much, Armando. And so, we do have a question from the audience. So Jasmine.
Thanks again, Cindy, and great presentation, Armando. From your research, did you find any specific type of programs in general that served as best practices to help combat this increasing issue?
So interestingly, I found that a lot of initiative has been taken from different senators and assembly members that after this report came out, there has been initiative to implement legislation that looks a little bit more closely at the impacts of suicide on adolescents and especially on now that we've been over through a whole year of in the pandemic, how that has impacted or how that impacts child mental health and the crisis especially. And I haven't found any specific cases that related to, aside from implementing education, but it has been really interesting to see how other assembly members and politicians have been really pushing forward for more programs to be implemented. For example, I believe there was one, AB 115, if I'm not mistaken, that is trying to implement a study that looks into different school districts on how COVID has impacted teen mental health or child mental health more specifically. So it's been really interesting to see how these findings have really brought mental health crisis for teenagers or for children in general into the forefront for politicians.
All right, great. Thank you, Armando. And thank you, Jasmine, for the question as well as for hosting Armando this term. So our next student is Valentina Chan, and her home campus is UC San Diego. And this term she interned with the Cal Asian Chamber of Commerce.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming today. Let me just share my screen.
Armando, I think you're going to need to go ahead and stop sharing so that Valentina can share.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, thank you.
No worries. So voting is considered to be the voices of the American population, as people get to have a say in politics when they vote. However, some people are being silenced because they don't understand the language of voting, quite literally. There are over 18 million Asian voters residing in the United States, and of them, 6 million have limited English proficiency. This means 6 million voices are not being heard because they can't understand the language of the ballot. Nevertheless, even in the face of institutional barriers, Asian Americans have become an electoral force, a force that still needs institutional support. With the focus on Section 203 of the Voting Rights Act, I examine the effects of language access materials on the Asian population in the United States. Section 203 required certain areas with language minorities to provide bilingual voting materials and on-site translators, and I hypothesize that Section 203 coverage increases, Asian voter turnout also increases. To test this hypothesis, I compared Asian voter turnout to the national voter turnout in presidential elections as coverage under Section 203 changed, starting from 2000 to 2016. I found that voter turnout for both the national and Asian population generally increases over time. But with the presence of confounding variables such as demographic changes, I am unable to determine a direct causal relationship between language access materials and increased voter turnout. Further research and data needs to be collected, and I ultimately recommend restructuring Section 203's coverage requirements and connecting with Asian communities to determine the most effective resources required to increasing voter turnout. Thank you. Are there any questions I can answer?
All right, great. Thank you so much, Valentina. And so, and we have a question from Janice Garcia. Just unmuted you, Janice.
Thank you, and hi, everyone. Valentina has been a great resource for us here at the Cal Asian Chamber, and we're very excited to see her project today. So I had a question. I know that there needs to be further research on the 2020 election statistics, and I wanted to see if there is an increase, how we can change outreach for API communities in the 2024 election.
Yeah, thank you for the question. I think that connecting with Asian communities would be the best route to go, because I came across some anecdotes saying how the translated materials that were provided by Section 203 were not very accurate and were often more confusing than the English version. So I think connecting with these communities and finding out what they really need and what kind of resources that they need to get to the polls and actually understand their ballots would be the next step.
Perfect. Great job, Valentina.
Great. Thank you so much, Valentina. And thank you, Janice, for hosting Valentina this term and for your question. So, all right. And so our next student is Christopher Mawad, whose home campus is UC Davis. And this term, he interned with the Local Government Commission.
Hello. Thank you for coming today. So, there we go. Cool. So believe it or not, it's 2021. And in January, plans created by agencies under the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act became effective across 21 California groundwater basins. However, assessments of the plan show consideration of groundwater quality varies tremendously. This project seeks to identify differences between plans which do consider groundwater quality and plans that do not, for 11 groundwater basins in the San Joaquin Valley identified in Figure 1. Specifically, does the percentage of contaminated agency wells or the interest of water users in each agency change as water quality is considered? And my hypothesis was that there will be an observable difference between plans that do and do not adequately address water quality in the proportion of water user groups in each agency, and that well contamination will be higher among plans which do not consider groundwater quality. To answer this question, this project is composed of three sections. The first was the creation of a scorecard, which served as the dependent variable. And the second and third sections compared the score against two different independent variables, the first being the percentage of contaminated agency wells, and the second being the proportion of the 224 water user interests within the 87 agencies. And the results were shocking. As figure two shows, there is no observable trend in the percentage of agency well contamination between plans of different scores. Significantly, figure three shows that there is a clear observable trend in user interest composition of agencies between plans of high and low scores. Specifically, plans which did not address quality were composed of 44% agricultural and 38% municipal interests, whereas plans which did address water quality were composed of merely 29% agricultural and 63% municipal interests. Therefore, as water quality scores increased, users with agricultural interests decreased and municipal interest increased. These findings are impactful because as more plans are scheduled to be implemented next year, it has been revealed through data that water user interests rather than actual groundwater conditions may play a larger role in decision-making. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Christopher. And so we're gonna go over to the audience for a question. And so we've got a question from Emily Finnegan. There we go.
Excellent, thank you, Chris. And this is really fascinating research, particularly for the Local Government Commission as we're working on implementing the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act. So this is such thorough work and I really love these visuals. One question in regard to stakeholder engagement, which seems to really influence the degree to which water quality is considered for these plans. Do you have any recommendations or come across, did you look at broader stakeholder engagement practices as a part of this effort, or any suggestions or next steps on how to improve that type of diverse engagement for the upcoming plans?
Yeah, so to collect data on interests of stakeholders, I simply visited each of their websites and kind of saw what each stakeholder said they used water for. And I think this research builds on research already conducted by the UC Davis Ecology Group under Kristen Dobbin, who identified that residents of these communities want to be involved in SGMA. However, and there is provisions within SGMA that does require local community involvement, especially with disadvantaged communities. However, the community involvement is focused in the implementation stage, but I believe that this data shows that there should be more community involvement in the actual planning stage as these plans are drafted. So I would say that there would need to be a stricter adherence to already existing provisions in the planning stage rather than in implementation. Mm-hmm. So yeah, did that answer your question?
Absolutely, yeah, that's really interesting. Thank you, Chris.
Great, Emily, for hosting Christopher this term and also for your question. And great job, Christopher. And so our next student is Yendi Padilla Hernandez, whose home campus is UC Merced. And this term, she interned with the Mexican consulate.
Hello, I'm just gonna share my screen. Okay. So hello, everybody. The coronavirus pandemic has left millions of Californians in economic struggle. They are unable to afford their basic essential needs. Therefore, both state and federal government have collected and provided multiple funds, such as the CARES Act, Coronavirus Aid Relief Economic Security Act, and the DRAI, the Disaster Relief Aid for Immigrants. Which leads me to my questions. What are the main causes immigrants requested stimulus checks during the coronavirus pandemic? And are Californian immigrants satisfied with the eligibility requirements as well as the quantity of funds provided? I hypothesize that immigrants are most likely to receive less funds because they cannot meet eligibility requirements. To answer this question, I use data from the Coalition for Humane Immigrants' Rights and perform a large in studies. In figure two, I found the five main reasons why immigrants reported the reason for needing to apply, which was due to having their work hours reduced. Meanwhile, in figure three, on a scale of 0 to 100%, I found housing being the category with the highest percentage in which how much they still need to pay off. Due to the DRI $75 million budget, it was only able to help 150,000 undocumented immigrants in receiving the funds. Fortunately, the good news is that Governor Newsom announced an economic relief package of $600 where undocumented immigrants can now meet qualifications for the state stimulus fund. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Yendi. And so if there is a question in the audience from her internship host site, go ahead and raise your hand. All right, if not, I'll go over to the academic team. All right, I've got a question from Maria Professor Pantoja.
Hi, hi Andy, great job. So I have a question about your hypothesis. So you hypothesized that Californians are satisfied with the amount of funds they received. Did you end up finding any data on whether the funds that people did receive helped with meeting those needs or just on how satisfied they were with the funds and what went unmet?
Yes, thank you for the question. So in figure three, you can see that there's five categories in which immigrants did reported, for example, housing, 87% not meeting their needs, as well as in food, transportation, and utilities. So, and overall, you can say that they were not satisfied because not all their needs, the fund did not cover all their needs, all their basic essential needs.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so you measured satisfaction in terms of unmet needs. All right, thank you.
All right, great. Thank you for the question. And thank you very much, Indy, for the presentation today. And so our next student is Luis Sanchez. His home campus is UCLA, and he interned at the Mexican consulate this term.
Let me just share my screen here. Okay. So today I will be presenting on the ease of access to college affordability and its effects on the share of undocumented students in higher education. By the year 2025, California will likely encounter a shortage of workers with some post-secondary education, but less than a bachelor's degree. As a matter of fact, the future gap among some college-educated workers may be as high as 1.5 million, even bigger than the projected 1 million worker shortage of college graduates. This means that California has to do as much as possible to encourage Californians to attend college. And this is where the importance of college-educated undocumented students comes into play. We ask ourselves, does the ease of access to affordable college increase the share of undocumented students in higher education? My hypothesis suggests that states that have lower number of requirements for undocumented students to qualify for in-state tuition have a higher share of undocumented students in college. My research looked at California, Texas, Florida, and Georgia, and compared the number of requirements that undocumented students must meet in order to qualify for in-state tuition. California and Florida had the same amount of requirements, and Texas had one more than California and Florida. Georgia did not have any legislation at all that allowed for undocumented students to pay for in-state tuition. My analysis did not support my hypothesis because states like California and Florida have less requirements than Texas, but Texas has a higher share of undocumented students in college. I believe that the reason why states that have more requirements and a higher share of undocumented students in college could be due to the fact that there are other socioeconomic factors, like if students can apply for in-state grants, that are also affecting the share of undocumented students in higher education. Thank you.
All right, great. Thank you so much, Luis. And so if there is a question from the internship host site, if you can just raise your hand and I'll call on you. All right. And if not, over to the academic team, and I've got Paige Peloton.
Thank you for this, Lewis. Interesting project. I was hoping you could provide for us some context about what these specific requirements are across the three states you found them in.
Yeah. So depending on the state, it varies on the nature of each requirement. Most states require that each student complete at least 3 years of high school in their state. But for example, Texas required students to actually sign an affidavit stating that they will pursue documented status at some point. California did not have that requirement. And then for example, Florida, and like in California and Texas, you could actually apply, they have legislation where you can apply for in-state grants, but Florida did not have that program or that legislation.
Thank you.
All right, great. Thank you, Luis, for your presentation today. And so our next student is Isabella Velarde. Her home campus is UC Santa Barbara, and she interned with the Mexican consulate this term.
Hello, let me just share my screen. Right. So I did my project on how the underfunding of school art programs affects students in California. Just want to make sure I was not unmuted. Okay. Out of the 1,024 schools in the LA Unified School District, only 419 provide art classes for students. Though the Education Code of California states that visual and performance arts content is required to be taught in schools, most fail to provide an adequate art program, especially in areas that have a large majority of marginalized students. The question I will be looking at is how the unequal funding of art programs in California public schools affects students. I hypothesize that an increased access to art programs creates a better educational outcome for marginalized students. By performing a program evaluation on 10 different California public school districts and scoring them on a scale from 1 to 5 and ranking them based off of the 5 categories as shown in figure 2, I was able to see a very steady correlation between higher test scores and how well funded a school district's art program is, helping to conclude that art classes do help stimulate higher test scores. I also found that schools that were ranked the highest also had a high rating in art classes provided, median household income, and overall daily attendance, but ranked lower in the diversity category. Schools that were ranked the lowest overall had their highest scores only in the diversity category. Racial disparities also became clear as looking closer, we see that the higher rated schools in the program evaluation have a higher percentage of white students in rich communities, while the lowest and lower ranking schools have a larger majority of minority students in poorer areas, as you can see in figure three. The lack of accountability points to a creation of a policy that would allow governmental regulation to evaluate each school district on how equitably they are distributing their funding and if they are giving students, specifically marginalized students, the same opportunity as their white peers. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Isabella. And there's a question from the Mexican consulate in terms of the audience. Just go ahead and raise your hand and I'll go ahead and call on you. All right, and if not, over to the academic team. All right, Professor Butters.
Hi, Bella. Great presentation here, Professor Butters, Paul 106E. I just wanted to hear more. I mean, I know a lot about it because we talked about it a lot. I just want to hear more about how you constructed your measure for your grading of these different school systems, and specifically, like, what exactly it means. What does a one mean? What does a five mean on your rating scale?
Yeah, so I got five different categories. It was median household income, art classes provided per school district, CAST test scores, which tests math and English proficiency, daily attendance per district, and school demographics, and this is all per district. And then I rated them on a 1 through 5. So one being rated like the lowest out of all those categories, in each category, one being rated the lowest, like they scored very low in their test scores, or their overall daily attendance was very low compared to the other schools. And then a 5 would be they scored the highest in said category. And then I would add them all up together. And then after that, I would add it all together and then put it out of 25 because 5 categories. 5 is being the highest. So the highest score you could get was a 25 out of 25. And that's how it would go. And then the 4s, 3s, 2s would be in the middle, kind of like they're almost there, but not there. So that's how I went off of rating that, just looking at all the different school years. I looked at 3 different school years and went off of the data that I was given by, I was able to find through the California Educational, California Department of Education database. And that's how it was done. I hope I explained that well enough. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Bella. Great job.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Isabella. And so our next student is Chelsea Acevedo, and she is from, her home campus is UC Irvine. And this term she interned with California Forward. Chelsea.
Hi, everyone. I'm just pulling up my screen share. Let's see. All right, so thank you all today in joining my conversation in Uncuffing Our Youth, and let's discuss the truth. So in the United States, an estimated 2.1 million youth under the age of 18 have been arrested. Since the late 1990s, the rates of juvenile arrests have declined. However, we have not seen this downward trend equally across racial demographics. This makes me ask, do children of color who live in low socioeconomic areas experience higher rates of juvenile arrest than children of color who live in high socioeconomic areas? In my research, I hypothesize that children of color who live in low socioeconomic areas will experience higher rates of juvenile arrest than children of color who live in high socioeconomic areas because of the impact of poverty. In order to test my hypothesis, I did a comparative case study in which I compared the socioeconomic status focusing on poverty levels to the number of juvenile arrest rates among 4 counties in California. In figure 1, you can see my first case study was between Contra Costa County and Sacramento County, which both have a high percentage of youth of color, but a difference in poverty level. And my second case study was between Trinity County and Mono County, which have a low percentage of youth of color, but again, a difference in poverty levels. While my research shows in figure 2 that children of color who live in low socioeconomic areas do experience higher rates of juvenile arrest than children of color who live in high socioeconomic areas, in figure 3, you can also see that Trinity County, where the majority of the youth population is white, had the highest poverty level and juvenile arrest rate among the 4 counties.
Through these findings, I suggest to reduce the consequences of having a criminal record for youth and to prohibit policies that raise misdemeanors to felonies for the most committed youth crimes. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Chelsea. And so I do see that there is a question from the audience. Susan Levenberg.
Hello, everyone. Chelsea, thank you for your presentation. It was terrific. And to all of the other students who presented, really interesting presentations. Thank you. So Chelsea, we have been delighted to have you at California Forward this term and look forward to you continuing with our Young Leaders Advisory Council. And my question to you is just how would you like to see this work carried forward by our young leaders? I know it's an issue of great importance to you.
Yeah, so I think that's a really great question and a really great conversation. I think that can happen in a multitude of ways. First, I think the young people need to get involved in this. I think we need to recognize what's happening to the youth and so we can start rallying and unionizing. And then I also think that we need to have these discussions with schools. So we need to look at how are schools criminalizing youth behavior. And since we go to school literally K through 12 and then some of us will go on to college, I think that is a really important place that needs to have this conversation as well. How can we support our youth? What policies can we have in school that do not criminalize behavior, but instead focus on mental health resources, counselors, psychologists, and making a safe space on campus for students?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Susan, for the question and also for hosting Chelsea this term. And so great job, Chelsea, on your poster presentation today. And so I'm going to just give Brooke the okay to go ahead and stop the recording here.